Hi, this is Colleen Quinn, and welcome to Quimbee. Today we're going to talk about the ethical representation of placing parents in adoptions. But let me tell you a little bit about myself first. I've been practicing law now for 32 years in Richmond, Virginia. I own the law firm of Locke & Quinn along with my partner, and as part of that, I run the Adoption and Surrogacy Law Center. In my practice of adoption and surrogacy law, I have served as president and on the board of trustees of the Academy of Adoption and Assisted Reproduction Attorneys. And when I first became a member of the Academy, one of the first things I was assigned to do was become the chair of the Birth Parent Rights Committee. And as part of that process in being chair for 6 years, I really learned a lot about the ethical representation of placing parents in adoptions. And that's what we're going to talk about today, how to properly represent placing parents versus not properly represent them. So one of the first things that we are going to do is that I'm going to apologize in advance for using the term birth parent at any time in this presentation. Some adoption proponents, especially social workers in the field, will readily point out that a more appropriate term is placing parent or something similar. However, the adoption statutes in most states, like Virginia, refer to such placing parents as birth parents. In fact, a couple of states actually use the term natural parent. Please, at all costs, avoid the term natural parent. So I'll tell you a quick story about the use of the term birth parent versus placing parent. I was presenting for a large audience up in Washington, D.C., which consisted of a lot of attorneys and social workers. And I was on a panel of about 5 people. And one of the members on the panel, who is a well-known social worker who's written many books on the topic, was part of the panel. And as I was presenting, I kept using the term birth parent because that's what's in Virginia statute and most statutes. And at one point, this gentleman pointed out to me and said, "Colleen, birth parent's not really a proper term." And I said, "Oh, well, what term would you prefer that I use?" And the gentleman said, "Expectant parent with a placement plan." And I said, "Well, you know, we attorneys get paid by the word, don't you?" In an effort to deflect the kind of verbal reprimand I had just received. But at any rate, it has stuck with me for a long time. And I try when I can to use the term placing parent as opposed to birth parent. Although most birth parents that I have represented don't seem to be offended by the term birth parent and just acknowledge that that's in fact what they are. At any rate, we're going to talk today first about some conflicts of interest in representing a placing parent. So most state ethical codes and the model rules of professional conduct provide that it's a conflict of interest for an attorney to represent both the adopting parents and the placing parents in an adoption. The best practice is to always have separate representation for the birth parents. It's much more difficult for a placing parent to challenge an adoption if they've received separate legal representation. When a placing parent goes unrepresented, the integrity of the adoptive placement is at much greater risk. Most judges expect that a placing parent will be represented, especially if you're going before a court and giving an in-court consent. In some states, unlike Virginia, where an in-court consent is not required for a private placement, placing parents may go unrepresented. They may just sign a consent before a notary or out of court. However, the best practice, the most ethical practice, is to always have separate representation for the placing parent, especially the placing mother, even if it's an out-of-court consent that's being signed or relinquishment or entrustment. Also, when an attorney or even a social worker is representing a birth parent, typically his or her fees are being paid by the adoptive parents. In such event, it's always important to explain to the birth parent in writing with a signed disclosure and a waiver form signed by the placing parent that even though you are being paid by the adoptive parents, your job is to represent that birth parent, and that's your ethical obligation. So when we look at conflicts of interest under the model rules of professional conduct, rule 1.7, conflict of interest, current clients, that rule sets out the proposition that a lawyer shall not represent a client if the representation involves a concurrent conflict of interest. That's basically the rule that requires that we have separate representation for adoptive parents versus placing parents. That rule further says that a concurrent conflict of interest exists if there is a significant risk that the representation of one or more clients will be materially limited by the lawyer's responsibilities to another client, a former client, or a third person, or by a personal interest of the lawyer. That's basically the rule that makes it clear that we really can't represent adoptive parents and placing parents, because the placing parent always has the option of changing their mind, and they may not decide to go through with the adoption. So there is definitely a conflict of interest that exists in trying to represent both.